BBC Audio presents M.R. James, Stories I Have Tried to Write, a series of full-cast ghost stories by Sheila Hodgson. In 1929, M.R. James penned an essay called Stories I Have Tried to Write, in which he detailed plots that had failed to blossom and fragments of tales that never materialised, recalling them for the benefit of someone else. In this BBC radio series, Sheila Hodgson takes advantage of his generosity, fleshing out these ideas into full-blown dramas. A Whisper in the Ear by Sheila Hodgson, based on an idea by M.R. James, with David March as James.
I've told many stories, ghost stories, only ghost stories. I never cared to try any other kind. And the question arises, do I believe in ghosts? Well, I'm prepared to consider evidence and accept it if I'm satisfied. Here in my study, there's a desk full of notes, random jottings which never quite materialized, half-formed ideas that nudge the mind from time to time. They affect me like a tap on the shoulder, a whisper in the ear. Consider, for example, the curious business of the travelling companion. Wait, let me open the drawer. You shall judge for yourself. Ah, here we are. I'd been on a bicycling tour. I was on my way to meet Anstey Guthrie in Troyes. Bicycling down one of those long French roads, I had the misfortune to hit a stone and fall quite heavily, throwing the machine against a tree. While attempting to repair the damage, I heard a voice calling, a young English voice. I say, excuse me, are you all right? Are you all right?
I saw you take a bit of a tumble. Can I help?
Now, how did you guess I was English?
I heard you say something that sounded awfully like, damn.
Ah. I suppose it's too much to hope you're a trained mechanic.
Good Lord, no. I'm a student.
Ah. My name is James, and if you could direct me to the nearest hotel. Is there something within walking or rather wheeling distance?
La Perrière. I'm staying there myself, as a matter of fact. I'm Robert Stafford.
I really am very pleased to see you, Mr. Stafford. Can you straighten that wheel a little?
Think so. Yes, if I just... There, no. Yeah. That's better.
Capital. On holiday?
It's the long vac, sir. I generally go abroad.
Of course. Which brings me to the essential question. Where are we?
Near Troyes, sir. The hotel's at Marcilly-la-Hare, in the Grand Place. It's not too bad. I've been there for 10 days.
Oh, really? An interesting town, then.
No. I wouldn't call it... No. Oh, look! There's La Perrière, behind the trees.
We came to an open square, and he pointed to a three-gabled house. The manager... A thin fellow with a nasty habit of sucking his front teeth said, Chambre sans bain, monsieur. For all the world, as if he thought anyone who arrived on a bicycle, and a broken bicycle at that, couldn't possibly afford a bath. I took the register away from him. What is the date, Mr. Stafford?
August the 4th, sir.
4th of August. 1907. There you are.
Prénom, s'il vous plaît.
My dear man, those are my... Oh, I see your difficulty. M.R. James, not Mr. James. M.R. Montague Rhodes, if you care for the information.
I say, do forgive me, but are you Dr. James?
Yes, I am.
Don't you write magazine stories? Ghost stories?
Oh, if anything I have written in that line has given you pleasure, Mr. Stafford, I'm glad.
Do you mind if we sit down?
Why not? I think the porter is taking my bag up, and I should be glad of a rest.
It's very good of you, sir.
Shall we have some coffee?
Yes, please.
Garçon.
Oui, monsieur.
Deux cafés, s'il vous plaît.
Deux cafés. C'est un moment, monsieur.
Now, you have my attention, Mr. Stafford.
I was going to Troyes by train. I got into a carriage. There was nobody else there except this old French woman with a moustache. Well, I wanted to read, and I found I'd forgotten to buy any papers. I had nothing except a second-hand novel I picked up in Paris on the Rive Gauche, a leather-bound volume called Madame de Lichtenstein.
Merci bien. Do go on, Mr. Stafford.
Pretty dreary stuff, as a matter of fact. Until I came to a bit about Madame Blanche Angier, a formidable character with black hair parted down the centre, a moustache, and gold tooth which flashed whenever she opened her mouth. She lived in Marseille-le-Hare, and the chapter described how her son, Maurice, vanished one night in October and was never seen again. Madame Angier became distracted, but she adored the boy. She searched week after week. At this point, our train stopped with a jerk, and the old lady opposite me rose to get her baggage together. I glanced up and found myself staring at black hair parted in the middle, a moustache, and as she lifted the case down, a luggage label bearing the words Madame Blanche Angier, Marseille-le-Hare, France.
Do be careful with that cup.
It gave me a shock. I thought I must have fallen asleep. I must have dreamt. I couldn't resist it. Madame, I said, where are we? And as she answered, Trois, I caught the flash of a gold tooth.
Curious.
What do you make of it, sir?
My dear fellow, what is there to make of it? A travelling companion who is apparently described in your book.
Dr. James, this is 1907. The book was printed in 1783.
Have you reread the passage? Have you checked? I mean, that's the obvious thing to do, isn't it?
Don't you think I haven't tried? But the book runs to 900 pages in very fine print.
And meanwhile, you are kicking your heels in Marseille. You're not trying to find this mysterious Madame Angier.
I feel a sort of compulsion. I feel, please don't laugh, as if I'm under some kind of obligation. Do you know what I mean?
No.
It's as if I'd made a promise to someone and can't remember who it was or what I promised to do.
Mr. Stafford.
Yes?
You might care to show me that book before you go. I have some knowledge of these matters. It could be valuable, though I don't want to raise your hopes. And so we parted. My bedroom looked out across the square. It seemed clean enough, and I couldn't actually complain about the bed. But the moment I lay down that night, one quite horrid defect soon made itself apparent. Oh, how can anybody hope to sleep? Good gracious. Who's that?
Stafford!
Do you know the time? What's the matter?
I'm sorry. I realize I shouldn't disturb you, but there's nobody else, you see. And it's getting worse.
My dear boy, are you ill?
Please don't laugh. I think there's somebody outside my window.
Trying to break in? We must call the manager at once.
Could you come with me quickly? My room's just down the corridor.
You might at least give me time to put on my dress.
Well, I'm only asking you to look. I expect it's imagination, a check of the light. If you can't see it, well, I must be dreaming. And if I'm dreaming, I can always wake up, can't I?
I promise you. You are wide awake and standing on my dressing gown cord. Now, what is this?
I've been reading that book, doing as you suggested, trying once again to find the page. Well, I sat up in bed for hours, the blankets pulled tight across my chest. I give you my word, I wasn't tired. I wasn't tired in the least.
Mm-hmm.
I had the strangest sensation of being watched. I could hear the wind scratching around the house. The maid had left a gap in the curtains. I got up to close them.
Yes?
There was a hand
pressed against the glass. But as I got...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.